Okay, so we will start about the discussion of shared server. I think Abhishek, you wanted to know a lot about shared server, right? So we will go through that. There is not too much of a practical, I would say, but there is a little bit of understanding on what the shared server is. Configuring shared server is very simple, but why do we configure it? I think that understanding is kind of very important. So any idea from your existing knowledge what this shared server business is? Or have you heard of shared server?
Providing service to the clients.
Providing service to the clients, that's a server. Yeah. But what, from the Oracle's point of view, what is shared server?
Things are put up in queue so that they requests are handled in queue.
The requests are handled in queue. Something, okay, so you know a little bit of that shared server business. So we'll start with this thing. Any idea from your side?
There is no dedicated
path assigned
between a user
and the server process. Okay, I think all of us, we are kind of close to what that is. So let us jump into this thing. So this is my SGA, System Global Area. And inside my System Global Area, I have a buffer cache, I have a shared pool, I have redo log buffer. These are the three mandatory things. And then we have these processes, DBWR, CKPT, PMON, SMON, and LGWR. Up till now, we have talked a lot about DBWR, we have talked a lot about LGWR, we have also talked about PMON. We haven't gone into too much of details of CKPT, the checkpoint process, and the SMON. So we will do that when we discuss a lot about the backup recovery. And now this is my hard disk, and on my hard disk I have data files, and then I have control files, and I have redo files. Okay, so all this is and redo files. This is fine. Then there is a dedicated server process. Actually, we have seen listener also. We have seen the listener. So all this stuff is on one machine. Then on the client machine, we have the client side, which is, let us say, SQL Plus. Usually the client would be on a different machine and the server would be, Oracle server would be on a different machine. So client will initially contact the listener on port number 1521. The listener would say that, okay, you would like to connect to a database called as what was our database, Focus One, and I will start a dedicated server process for you, and then you contact that dedicated server process. And why it is a dedicated server process? Because it is going to work only for you. That's why it's dedicated to your client. So likewise, listener's job is to start dedicated server processes so the clients can connect to the dedicated server process. The moment client types the command exit in SQL Plus, this dedicated server process will vanish. The existence of this server process is from the existence of this. Okay, that is what we have seen so far. Now, what is the main thing that we need to understand about a dedicated server process? A dedicated server process is a good thing because it is a good thing for the client, because since it is dedicated, it is going to only work on the request, on the SQL statements that are submitted by the client. So this is one program which is responsible for giving answers to this SQL Plus client. Obviously, we had also seen the area which is associated, the memory area that is associated with the dedicated server process is called as a program global area, PGA. PGA is basically where it is a private area only for this server. This is a shared area which is managed, or which is accessed by quite a few processes. Dedicated server process is also one of them. But this PGA is the area which is private only to that server process, which means no other process can access the information in this area. That's the private area. If there is another dedicated server process, that dedicated server process will also have its PGA. Now, what is the purpose of PGA? What is inside the PGA? Inside the PGA are the variables, the session level information regarding the client, the session level information regarding the client, the cursor variables, the bind variables, all that PLSQL stuff, if you have done that, it is inside that PGA. Now, another important thing that we had seen inside the PGA is the sort area. Sorting happens here, sort area. There is a hash area for hashing, indexes and all that stuff. So these are the main things that are inside the PGAs. Now, this is all fine. Usually the PGAs are going to range from maybe 3 megabytes to 4 megabytes, you know. And how do you decide the size of a PGA? PGA aggregate target. If my PGA aggregate target is, let us say, 100 megabyte in my initialization parameter, what is going to happen? The PGA of this server, dedicated server process, plus the PGA of this dedicated server process, plus the PGA of all other, let us say, 50 different dedicated server processes that have been created by the listener for various 50 different clients. All the PGAs added together will not go beyond 100 megabytes. That is the PGA aggregate target. Now, if one dedicated server process requires more PGA because it is going to do little more sorting, then this PGA will expand. Maybe some other dedicated server's process PGA will contract so that this expansion can have some more room. So this will expand, this will contract, but eventually everything will be living together happily within 100 megabytes. That is what is happening. Everything is fine there. Now, as you start having more and more users, let us say the demand for the system is increasing. Instead of 50 users there are. You need something. Oh, left five. This one. So instead of, I have lost my train of thought. What was I saying? Number of users. So initially there were 50 users, and now suddenly the demand has grown, and suddenly we want 1,000 users to be connected to your system for whatever reason. The system is very nice. Everybody would like to connect to that. 1,000 users are going to get connected. Can the PGA of all those 1,000 users stay within 100 megabytes? And yes, if we have specified the PGA target to be 100 megabytes, yet they will have to cramp all those in those 100 megabytes. And suddenly, what will these people experience? These people will experience slowness in their performance because now the memory is shrunken. So what can we do? We will increase the PGA aggregate target from 100 to 200 to 300 to 400. But finally, there is a limitation. Let us say our memory that we have on the server is, let us take a hypothetical example of 1 gigabyte. This is my RAM, which is 1 gigabyte. Out of this RAM, there is certain part that is going to the operating system. Then there is some other programs, maybe if there is any Apache web server, if there are any other programs, then they will take certain memory depending on what is being run. If there are no other programs that are being run, then nothing would be there. Then there would be a memory requirement for the SGA. Let us say our SGA is equal to 500 megabytes. So this would be the SGA also going out of 1 gigabyte. And then the remaining things are available for our PGA or maybe for other programs. So that PGA we can grow only up till certain limit. We cannot grow it beyond certain limits. So if the OS is going to take 100 megabytes, if SGA is going to take 500 megabytes, then we are left only with remaining 400 megabytes for our PGA, for our program global area. So combined PGAs of all the servers will not be able to grow beyond 400. And at that time, you will suddenly start experiencing the slowness for all the clients that are getting connected. So what to do after this? You obviously have a choice of asking the management, give me more RAM than 1 gigabyte. But RAM is an expensive resource, so people usually will not give you immediately RAM. They will give you the hard disk, but not the RAM. So obviously now this is the point where we can think of using what is called as a shared server. So when we configure our Oracle instance with the help of this new technology called a shared server, suddenly the memory requirement for those new 1,000 users, it goes down. The memory requirement goes down. Even with the less amount of memory, you can perform or you can give better performance. So how is that done? That is what we'll see. So you should implement the shared server technology. You should configure your database to work as a shared server only if there is a need to connect many, many, many users and you don't have enough RAM for them. The first preference will always be to set up your database in a dedicated server mode. Why? Because dedicated is like super fast. You know, for every client there is a dedicated server process and the performance is very good. So that is the first preference. So considering that we have that limitation, we don't have enough RAM, and we have to set up our database in a shared server mode because of the growth that is happening, let us see how to do it. In the dedicated in the shared server environment, the listener is there, and when the database is started, database instance is started with the startup command, how many processes are going to get created? Only 5 here, and listener is a separate process. So these things are running. This is what happens in the dedicated server mode. When a user gets connected, a dedicated server process is created. But in the shared server environment, what happens? Along with these 5 processes, some other processes are also started during the startup time. So there are these processes. I will say D0, D1, and then S0, S1. S2. These are called as dispatchers. ATC, patch TRS, dispatchers, and these are called as shared servers. CHER. Okay, dispatcher and shared server. So these processes, along with these, are started when we start up a database instance. Now, how many dispatcher processes are started, how many shared servers are started, that is configurable based on the initialization parameters. So there are going to be 2 initialization parameters that we will discuss later. One for the total number of dispatchers that will get started, and one for the total number of shared servers that will get started. So now, how does this whole thing work? Now, this is started on the server side. On the client side, so let us say this is SQL plus. SQL plus client is going to contact the listener. The listener is going to say, okay, you would like to connect to the Focus One database. I would connect you to Focus One database, but I have realized, listener says that I have realized that this database is configured in a shared server environment. How does it know that the database has been configured in the shared server environment? This is what a shared server environment is. PMON is constantly talking with the listener and telling him all the details about the server. As I said, PMON does the dynamic registration and all that stuff. PMON also tells this guy that we are running a shared server environment. So PMON tells the listener that we are running a shared server environment, and therefore there are 2 dispatchers which are there. So PMON is telling listener that there are 2 dispatchers with us. What is a dispatcher? Dispatcher is basically a process which will be taking the request from the client now. So listener will tell the SQL plus client that there is a dispatcher running on such and such port number, contact that dispatcher. So this SQL plus will contact the dispatcher, and from this point onward, SQL plus is always in touch with that dispatcher D0. If there is another SQL plus session, it will contact the listener first. Listener will say, oh, we are running a shared server environment, and there are 2 dispatchers. The first dispatcher is handling 1 connection, so you should go to the second dispatcher. So the listener is actually doing a job of what is called as load balancing. Between the dispatcher 0 and dispatcher 1, listener is gonna route the request according to the load. So let us say the third guy, SQL plus guy, comes to D0, the fourth guy will go to this. Now the load is equal. Suddenly after that, 2 guys from D0, they type the command exit. So this guy is gone, this guy is also gone. So now the load on D0 is very less. Now D0, this whole thing is a part of a server. So PMON is aware of the fact that D0 is now not loaded heavily, and PMON tells the listener that D0 is less loaded, so next connection, connection number 5 will go to D0 and connection number 6 will also go to D0. So likewise, the communication between the PMON and the listener, which is telling the listener that the loads are different, and based on that, listener is gonna route the connections. So listener has routed the connection, and once the connection is routed, then what happens? Finally, this guy sends a SQL statement to the D0. D0 is just a middleman between the actual server process, which is going to do the entire work. Just like our dedicated server process. Our dedicated server process is responsible for reading data from, first thing, it is responsible for actually doing what? The parsing, the semantic parsing, then the syntax parsing also, the optimization code and all that stuff is done by the dedicated server process. Now that work will be done by the shared server process, but that is behind the scenes. It is not directly talking with the client. Okay, what is talking directly with the client is the dispatcher process. The shared server is behind the scenes. So now what happens, there is what is called as a request queue. So this is called as a request queue. Request queue is an area inside the memory. Actually, I have drawn it here, but it is actually sitting inside the shared pool. It is a memory area that sits inside the shared pool. So the request queue will have the first request that, okay, select star from orders table. So that request will go and sit inside the request queue. Then the second guy gives another request to D1. D1's request will be here. Then again D0's request, whichever request comes in that specific way, that is actually kept inside that called as a request queue. Request queue will have the requests, the SQL statements. Then what? Then these shared servers are going to pick up the first request that has come to you. Come to you means it is on the request queue. So it will pick up the first request. Then the second guy may pick up the second request. Third guy may pick up the third request. Then third guy will be finished with the third request because it is very quick. The select statement was very simple. So it was finished within half a second. The other two guys are still working on their select statement because they are lengthier. So since the second guy is now free, that guy will go and pick up the fourth request. So likewise, the load is automatically balanced between these three guys. Depending on who is least loaded, he will go and pick up the request. Once the request is picked up, the job will be done. What is the job? Reading the data from disk and bringing it into the buffer cache, parsing and all that stuff is done. Once the answer is found out, that answer is kept on what is called as a, there are queues now. There are three different queues. Okay, so I will draw three different queues here. Okay, hold on. Let me check just one thing. Okay, there are going to be not three in our situation. There are going to be two different queues. One for this dispatcher and another for this dispatcher. These are called as, okay, I will write it down here now. These are response queues. So response queue is also some memory area which is sitting inside shared pool. Okay, we have seen that what we have in the shared pool is actually the dictionary cache, library cache, all those things are there. Then we have also seen what else is there in the shared pool, the dirty list. Okay, which is called as a actual checkpoint list, the list of blocks that are dirty, that is also there in the shared pool. And these request queues and response queues, that is also some memory area that is also inside the shared pool. So what is there in that request queue? Whenever the answer is found out, you know, that goes on that request queue. Sorry, not the request queue, the response queue. Okay, how many response queues are there? As many dispatchers we have. If we have 10 dispatcher processes, there would be 10 response queues. How many request queues are we gonna have? Only one request queue for the entire database instance. This is the architecture that Oracle has designed. Then why is it required? I mean, how is this gonna help us reduce the memory requirement? As you can see, even if there are 100 people connected, how many dispatchers are handling all that stuff? Two dispatchers and 3 servers. So number of processes has been reduced. Now what about their PGAs? PGA is a program global area which was required for every client. That PGA, which was actually part of the dedicated server process, will be moved to the shared pool. That PGA will be moved to the shared pool. So if there are 100 clients, there would be probably 100 different small PGAs inside the shared pool. So now what we are doing here, we are actually doing one thing. As you can see, we have reduced the size of the PGA, or we have taken out the PGA and we have kept it inside the SGA. So the requirement for SGA has grown, but PGA has been reduced. So final memory requirement is still very huge. But one critical thing that happens, which we need to understand, is that these smaller PGA areas are there only for the active sessions. Only for the active sessions. Now, what is an active session? Active session is that if 10 of us we are connected to the database, how many sessions will be there in $V session? 10. But only one guy is probably executing a select statement at that moment. At that moment, only one is active, the remaining are inactive. You can go and check the status inside $V session. Almost all of them are inactive. So we are going to take advantage of this situation, that mostly 90% of the people, they are just sitting idle, their sessions are inactive, they are not actually typing any select statements or SQL statements, and therefore there is no need to have the dedicated PGAs for those inactive sessions. There is no need to have the dedicated PGAs for those inactive sessions. So we have actually shifted that load to the SGA. But since the PGAs are there only for the active sessions, this requirement is less. So even though the SGA size requirement has increased and the PGA has decreased, the size requirement that has increased is not very high. Why? Because we are counting on only one thing, that most of the people are sitting idle most of the time. And that is the main thing for implementing the shared server. And therefore, shared server is implemented only when there is a lot of user interface. Like for example, banking application, there would be around 10,000 users. How many are going to be actually active? When we go to the banking session, we are connected for, let us say, 10 minutes online banking. But out of those 10 minutes, we are probably checking the balance, maybe one SQL statement. We are logging in one SQL statement. We are doing quite a few other things, maybe 4 or 5 transfer of money. 5 or 6 statements, and we are there for 10 minutes. 5 or 6 statements for 10 minutes. 10 minutes the PGA is locked if it is a dedicated server. But now we're gonna say that most of the people are sitting idle. So that is what we're gonna take an advantage of. And there is a term there called as high think applications. So if you are web application or any client application is a high think application, that means you are requiring a lot of thinking time and less active time, then those applications are prime candidates for setting up the shared server. So that is when you set up the shared server. So let me kind of summarize in one small paragraph what is the shared server business is. When the memory availability on the machine is less and we require too many people to connect to the database, memory availability on the server is less and we require too many people to connect to the database, in that situation we implement shared server. Why? Because it is counting on many people thinking for longer time and acting for less time. Thinking means we are actually thinking whether I should hit commit or I should hit rollback, whatever that is, or I should delete or I should insert, or I should transfer the money, or I should check the balance. So we are doing a lot of thinking. So those are high think applications, as opposed to what? As opposed to data loading applications. They are not high think applications. They are loading huge amount of data within 10 seconds, 15 seconds and all that stuff. And we will see a little later SQL loader. SQL loader is a low think application. It is just gonna bombard database with the huge amount of data. So if there is any job which is gonna run in the nightly batch job, do not allow that job to run in a shared server environment. It will perform very badly. Performance would be very bad for that job. But manual intervention, best. So this is what the architecture is. Another thing is the PGA size is reduced. It goes inside the what is called as a shared server. Now, as you can see, shared pool is having a lot of small memory areas, critical memory areas in it. We have seen the dictionary cache, we have seen the library cache, we have seen the response queue, request queue, all those things are there, the dirty list as I had mentioned. So shared pool is getting loaded with a lot of area, and therefore Oracle says that whenever you are implementing shared server architecture, do not overload that shared pool. Do not overload this shared pool. You try to keep the PGAs in a separate area called as large pool. So there would be a separate memory area, just like buffer cache, shared pool, log buffer. There would be another area called as large pool. And the moment you set up the large pool by setting up one of the initialization parameters, all the PGAs will go to the large pool instead of going to the shared pool. That is done automatically. All the PGAs will go like that. So this is what the architecture of shared, or rather why shared server is implemented. Why shared server is implemented. Any? Bolo.
How many number of dispatchers can we set?
I think there is a limitation is 20, I think. I will check that limitation. But 20 dispatchers, usually now how many dispatchers should be set up, how many shared servers should be set up, all that is kind of a performance tuning thing. You initially start with certain number of assumptions and then you keep on checking whether these dispatchers are enough or not, or whether these shared servers are enough or not, by going into the $V dispatcher views, $V shared server views.
Depending on the performance of our database.
Depending on the performance of the user. There may be 1,000 users getting connected, but if they are not doing anything, then our 3 shared servers can manage them. Okay, we don't know that yet because we have to kind of collect the statistics. All that can be found out in, I will mention that $V shared server, shared underscore server, and similarly $V dispatcher. $V shared server and $V dispatcher are the two views which will show you a busy and idle column. Busy and idle. So if the servers are busy for a long time, then yes, it is time to add more servers. Same thing for the dispatchers. I think the rule of thumb is that if it is more than 50% active or 50% busy, you add one more shared server.
How we can check whether it is a shared server dedicated?
Okay, if you type the ps-ef command, you will see all the processes. So you will see pmon, smon and all that stuff. You will also see a process called as d0001, or I think 3 zeros, 000001d. All those are processes. Those are d000001, and server process are s000 and S001. So you will see that process over there. It means it's a shared server.
Okay, we have to check like this only.
We have to check like this. Any other way that you can check the initialization parameters, that we'll see. If the initialization parameters are set up, there is the initialization parameter for shared server and there is the initialization parameter for a dispatcher. If those initialization parameters are set, then yes, and your database is in the shared server mode. So with this discussion, we'll see now how to configure the database in the shared server mode and some other things. So any questions on why we should set up the shared server? Why? Maintain the performance. So when the user requirement is very high. Now it's a debatable issue. Many documents will say something like this, that shared server will increase the performance of the database. And this is kind of correct. If you have a dedicated server set up and you have 1,000 users connected, obviously 1,000 users are going to be cramped in that small PGA area and therefore performance would be less. And then suddenly you set up the shared server and the performance suddenly starts increasing. And it increases because of only one thing, because our application is high think. If the application is not a high think application, performance would still be bad. So I think that the shared server is not really a performance improvement technique. It will increase the performance. You will see the increased performance. It is actually a scalability technique. that from 10 users you can suddenly go to 1000 users because everything is high think application.
Disadvantage,
I would say that anybody who is connected to the shared server, I mean to a dispatcher and then a shared server, then the performance is going to be slow as compared to a dedicated server process. If I was connected to a dedicated server process and if the memory requirement was good, then I would get throughput very high. Okay, there is one good example I read somewhere. I will share that with you. It's like this. Have you gone to a restaurant? I think there are a couple of restaurants here in Pune also where you go there and you are sitting right in front of the chef, the guy who cooks. And you know, it's a very high scale restaurant, very expensive restaurant. You are sitting in front of the cook. That cook is there. He is cooking in front of you. There is a big stove and everything else. And if you go there in a group of four or five people, I mean, you are the customer. Four or five is a group of the customer, and that chef is cooking for you. So how does the whole thing work? You go there, he will greet you, and then you will look at the menu card. Looking at the menu card is a high think application. You are thinking, what am I going to eat? You think for 10 minutes. The chef is sitting idle. His memory resources are wasted. So think of chef as a dedicated server process. Okay, his resources are wasted. And then after thinking for half an hour, you tell, okay, you need this masala dosa. And he cooks masala dosa in front of you. He requires only 2 minutes to cook the masala dosa. And then he gives it to you and you are eating that for half an hour. So out of that 1 hour period, the chef is busy only for 2 minutes. And he is idle for the remaining almost 58 minutes. So, but what is the great thing? You got the greatest service. The moment you order masala dosa, you got it back. So high performance from the client point of view, the server is dedicated, the chef is dedicated. Now, what is the bad thing of it? The owner of the restaurant can serve only 10 customers at a time because he has only 10 chefs. Only 10 customers can be served, and that is a limitation. But servers are, I mean, the clients are getting best service. Now some smart owner will say, no, we need to change this thing. We need to, have more customers. So what is he going to do? He is going to have waiters and chefs will be inside. Nobody will see the chef. So he's going to just have waiters, which are dispatchers, dealing with the customers. They are just taking the orders and they are giving the orders to the chefs. Chefs are sometimes cooking the masala dosa for this guy and uttappa for this guy. So you never know who is going to cook your dosa and all that stuff. It is whoever is less loaded will actually serve your SQL statement. Which will actually serve your SQL statement. So by doing this thing, by having only two servers and three chefs, less than 10 employees, he is able to serve maybe 100 customers. Why? Because he is utilizing that time properly. So by utilize, and why this is, he is able to do it because most of the customers are high think customers. They are eating eating for a long time, they're thinking for a long time, but actually work that needs to be done for that customer is only for 2 minutes. That is what the main thing is. That is the main thing. Now just imagine a customer who is like the big demon, the Bakasur guy, who is constantly eating, and the chef is going to be very busy for that. So for that, it is always a good idea to give a dedicated chef. So for a SQL loader who is actually loading huge amount of data, he is constantly going to require huge amount of resources on the memory side. So it's always a good idea to give a dedicated server, a chef, to that SQL loader process. So we'll see also a little later on, if there are a customer like that, high requirement customer or high demanding customer, then can we give a dedicated server process for that one customer out of all the 1000 ones, and that one dedicated process will be there for remaining dispatchers and shared servers are there. So this is the analogy I read somewhere. I think it is a good analogy to understand what the dedicated server and shared server is.
So is there a ratio between the number of dispatchers and number of shared servers?
No, there is no ratio actually. You start with some certain assumptions and then you keep on checking the performance in those views. As I said, if the idle time is less, then you increase the shared servers.
It should be one more than the dispatcher, or it can...
No, it can be anything. It can be anything. You can have two dispatchers and only one shared server also. Doesn't matter. But you need to check the idleness of this guy and you need to check the idleness of these guys also. And even after this, you are unable to manage the volume, then what is the next solution? Any idea? That you want to the same database additional 1000 PS. Currently, we are managing 1000 with this one machine with the shared server, but now we want suddenly additional 1000.
Additional 1000 PS.
And memory requirement is still, you know, we cannot increase the size of the machine now. The machine already has huge amount of RAM. Connection spooling can be used, or these days heavily what people are doing is rack. A real application cluster is a classic example of this. You create one more node and you ask the remaining 1,000 guys to connect to this guy. So suddenly 1,000 guys, their SGA, their PGA is coming from that machine's RAM, and the remaining 1,000 guys are coming from this machine's RAM. So rack is actually a highly scalable solution. This is what the scalability is. You add one more node and you can have 1,000 people connected. That is what rack real application clustering is. Okay, so we'll stop here and we'll jump to the how to set up the shared server in the next section.